in some ways I have a question about beauty in relation to love. So maybe we can talk about that in a moment. Because love is also a function. Do you want to do that?
Yeah. I was thinking of maybe talking about beauty specifically, but also I was curious about your experience of excess and if that is something that characterized, I mean, maybe you can talk a little bit in a broad sense about the contours of that politicization, like encountering punk, and was that also, how was that bound up with kind of experiences of excess, or does that resonate?
Yeah. Am I loud enough on my own, or should I
use your
mic? Okay.
I guess for me, one of the things I just find so interesting about one of the reasons why I wanted to do the beauty project was that I was writing about war and I was writing about empire, and beauty was this kind of often appeared as a detail, and there was kind of this way in which it was imagined to be in excess of what really mattered, right? So I found that interesting, the way that beauty would weave itself in these stories that I was reading and thinking about. Refugees and refugee camps and war and empire and the ways in which oftentimes when I would tell people about these encounters, they would be like, oh, well, that's in excess of the real story, which is about the movement of troops or these discourses of civilization and things like that. And I was like, I always wanted to stop that impulse in myself and in others to imagine that beauty is just something that is in excess of the real story behind states or conditions of violence. And I wanted to think about them together and what they were doing and why it was that beauty kept appearing in these stories of war and disaster and crisis. As this kind of detail that was nonetheless this kind of moment where it was often described as this moment where someone would be able to stop and have some kind of experience of life being furthered that was somehow in excess of the situation or the conditions under which they lived. So that was really interesting to me in terms of thinking about how I came to this project. I mean, so this is literally the excess of my first project. This is all stuff that I didn't get to write about in my first project. I wrote about it a little bit, but not too much. And so this is like, I just went back and was looking through my files, and I was like, oh, I've already written parts of this in discarded chapters of my dissertation. So it is literally the excess of some of the things I've been thinking about that. You know, again, like when I tell people that I write, like for instance, when I was writing about the NGO called Beauty Without Borders, which was an NGO that set up a beauty school in Kabul after the U.S. occupation that was about teaching Afghan women the art and commerce of beauty, and people would be like, oh my God, you know, this is so frivolous, this is not the story of the war. But I'd be like, well, why not? Like, why can't you tell the story of the war through this kind of attachment to the promise of beauty as a way of living on in the midst of something disastrous and terrible and awful, when that is a story that comes up so much in every war? There's a story, when we think about the way in which people talk about beauty and whether or not we can write poetry anymore after the Holocaust, or, you know, questions about the aestheticization of suffering and humanitarian imagery, right? I mean, there's a way in which like these kinds of questions are always often understood as the excess, right? When people talk about humanitarian porn or poverty porn, right? Like, this, the porn is the sign of excessive to call something humanitarian porn or poverty porn is to say that it's excessively affective in a way that distracts us from understanding the political constitution of that thing that is pictured there. But why is it, why is porn bad? But two, what does it mean to imagine that that's excessive when that's maybe actually part of its premise? And you know, and so so those are some of the things I was thinking about in terms of this project and how they become, and how this thing, this excess that is often imagined to be sort of an add-on or just a story that illustrates something else is actually maybe the story of the violence itself. To go to your question, I'm talking a lot, sorry, but about the politicization, definitely for me, when I discovered punk, it was very much the kind of eruptive aspects of punk that I loved. It was you know, in 1991, there were the Gulf War riots, and then of course, you know, also around the same time, there were the Rodney King riots in LA and San Francisco. And I remember being a teenager and sitting in my room and looking at pictures of punks rioting in Maximum Rock and Roll and just being so in love with these people who were just like, whose feelings about these injustices were so excessive that they went out and fucked shit up, right? So and that was really both aesthetically and politically appealing to me, right? I mean, that's, you know, again, as I said before, like when I think about those radical acts that comprise the aesthetic and radical histories of resistance that inspired me most as a young person, these are punk and street protests, right? It's like, again, the Gulf War, the Rodney King riot, the regular efforts of Antifa to shut down white supremacist marches, whether it was, I grew up in San Diego, whether it was the white Aryan resistance in San Diego or in San Francisco, it was the National Front or the American Front. Those were the things that were really key to my understanding, to my politicization.
There's something as you were talking, I was thinking a little bit about one of the things I like about your presentation and what you're kind of talking about vis-a-vis beauty is also maybe what you have used in other context, but thinking of beauty as a minor condition, which isn't typically how beauty is addressed, I think. And I could you maybe talk a little bit, I was intrigued in the kind of gathering some interaction before we arrived at this moment. Mimi used the term sort of minor object, and talking, I think, about a relationship between the objects that proliferated out of some of the zine, sort of your own zine work and the zine and punk movement, but also the relationship between the minor object and the archive. I recently completed a project where I was interested in newsletters that were written between 1955 and 1977, lesbian, feminist, queer, proto-trans, and one of the things I was really interested in about those, of course, their life is in the archive, but there's maybe two things that happen that feel like they relate to what you were thinking about with minor object. One is that their life is in the archive, which I think you may have things to say about sort of the death of the archive, but for me, there's something very interesting about those newsletters, which is that they, particularly for the forms of subjectivity and politics that were being engaged, that I was particularly interested in, they were dependent upon a kind of protected publicity. That the newspaper, the newsletters were subscription newsletters, and so the act of publicizing was totally important to the politics growing. Like someone had to say, I am X, and someone else had to read it and say, I am that too, and I recognize myself there, and I never knew anybody existed like me. Like that the publicity was important, but so too was the sense of a kind of protection, a protection from a larger vulnerable and violent kind of calling out or being called out or being named or being, you know, losing health, losing job, losing security. So And in that, I also found myself interested in the early 90s. As I was thinking about those newsletters, I spent a little detour thinking about the BBS, the, what's it called, the bulletin, broadcast bulletin service, like the first kind of, back in the olden days of the internet. So textual-based kind of communications that happened inside of like a usernet group. And there were a number of different sort of queer groups that formed, and I found one of the moderators of this early lesbian one that I was interested in, and asking her, like, were those ever archived? And she was like, oh God, I hope not. And I think it's interesting for me because in some ways with the newsletters, I have come upon, I guess, the feeling that that form of political formation is really, really important. And so thank God for the archive to hold these things that are minor. Like newsletters don't have any other way to exist because they don't get republished by and large, some in larger magazines, but they're so sort of, they're considered such a minor literature that they don't rise to that sort of level of distribution. And so, yeah, maybe if you have thoughts about that in particular related to your own, I think, work on republishing zines.
Well, I would actually like to hear you talk a little bit more about this publicity, a perfected publicity thing. Like, what was it? What is it about that that seems important in
publicity? I mean, at that time, I think what's interesting to me is to think part of this is maybe indicative of how I encounter history. So when I came out in the early 90s, it was this kind of moment of like the first, some of the first rhetoric or kind of signage I saw back about myself was dyke power, gay power. And through that encounter, then I had to understand what the affiliation was between gay liberation and black liberation, between gay power and black power, and often my encounter with history is pushing myself beyond a kind of first understanding. So the first understanding around gay power being about visibility and then kind of connecting it to literal multi-issue affiliational politics was important. And then from that perspective, often the return was to gay liberation, and anything prior to gay liberation was seen, you know, in a kind of anecdotal way, as by me and a lot of people I was in conversation with. We just kind of pushed it to the side because it was thought of as assimilationist and bound up in certain kind of protections and a certain kind of politic. And to engage with these newsletters in a more in a deeper way, the thing that was interesting to me was to think about the role of what I could say is the boundary, like that publicity, that form of publicity had a boundary that was very different. And you can see it as you move through that time period, 55 to 77, you can see it shift. And you can see the nature of the interactions that people would have with each other out on the street change, because with some of the communications vis-a-vis those newsletters in the 50s and 60s, that is the only communication that's happening, or for many of the people who are communicating. So it's happening through reading and writing. And then you see the interaction between embodied encounters that feed into the newsletters, where then it's about, like, let's advertise this event, or let's advertise this event, or let's call out and have and recruit, and they take on a different form. So I guess it's not that I was inherently interested in protection, but that it really changed and elaborated, clarified something for me about a kind of this bind between what I could call the technologies of distribution, like, you know, writing and reading, mimeographed, low budget. There's constantly in these newsletters like discussion about like money and not having enough money and who's making the Xeroxes, and we had a postal code but we have to change it because we don't have money for that office, so we're gonna go to that office, and it's all often being done out of people's homes. So there's this precarity, and the precarity is really like kind of profoundly held by the urgency and necessity of those communications. So, yeah, I don't know if that clarifies a little bit.
Yeah, I think that's really helpful.
It does, because that's part of why I ended up writing that piece. It's called Minor Objects, and it's about the circulation of zines into archives that then become objects of academic inquiry. Because, you know, the original conditions for their manufacture or their creation was very much that kind of protected publicity, right? It's the small, intimate public that we imagined ourselves addressing. And then to encounter it in the archive or in an academic journal is a radical transformation of the conditions under which I know I imagined my zine circulating. And I wanted to think, and I'm sorry, I'm gonna reference the thing I wrote because I can never remember what exactly I say about anything. I wanted to think about what has changed in the increasingly institutional encounter that narrates a history of minor threats. Oh, actually, the article is called Minor Threats. See, I don't remember things. As a productive site for archival accumulation and intellectual inquiry, while I focus on punk in the field of cultural politics, and to be more specific, punk feminism and women of color punk feminisms, so I follow cues from transnational post-colonial feminist studies and queer public critique to take up questions about minor objects as entry points for disruption and discipline, especially where power and knowledge together aim to capture the minor object. Here, the concept of minor objects describes those marginal forms, persons, and worlds that are mobilized in narrative, including archival constructions to designate moments of crisis, that can also be recruited to manage or overcome those limits and their laying bare, especially through acts such as recognition and inclusion. So one of the things I was interested in when I asked you about the protective publicity thing and thinking about archives, which is again a thing I'm interested in, is like, I don't know if anybody saw it, but like librarians are always having conversations about how to ethically archive things like zines and newsletters and stuff like that. And I remember reading a piece recently about, speaking of pornography, On Our Backs, the lesbian porn magazine from the 80s, I think, 90s, and what it meant to digitize this collection of On Our Backs and to put it, to make it accessible to a wider audience than it originally imagined of dykes and lesbians, and you know, to put these pictures out there in the digital sphere of people who may or may not have any idea that this is happening to their images, and for what purpose, right? So what does it mean to archive these minor objects from LGBTQ subcultures or from punk or so on and so forth? What does it mean to bring these objects from the past that had a particular kind of audience that was imagining these intimate publics, and to then transform them into objects of archival and academic inquiry? So that's why I was asking about that. I don't know if you have any response to that.
I guess what I was thinking about is I think a lot in my work about the mode of address and what transformation happens when you engage a historical document and reinsert it in a present moment. And I think it is interesting. It's interesting to think about maybe performance, and particularly performance, that the ability of that form or medium to readdress. I've been really interested and very specific in.
Exchange, I find really interesting how the competing narratives that are unfolding about last night, where they locate the actual crisis.
Mm-hmm.
Is the crisis that a gay fascist was on campus speaking, who was going to launch a campaign with David Horowitz to shut down sanctuary universities? How come that's not cited as a crisis in the Chancellor's response?
Why is the crisis not what is happening that makes that person's popularity so, and that what is happening that a gay fascist can do these kinds of things and then the president tweets in support of him, right? And then threatens to punish this university, which has no leverage because he was already going to punish us all anyway. How people identify what the crisis is, how they